Right? Of India, Sri Pranam Mukherjee, Bharat Ratna, Sri Tawarchand Gahlot, Union Minister, Sri Harivamshiji, Deputy Chairman, Rajya Sabha, Sri Rajyavardhan Rathod, Minister for Information, Broadcasting, Youth Affairs and Sports, Sri Subharao, Secretary Vice President, Sri Amit Khare, Secretary Information Broadcasting, Excellencies from different countries who have made it possible to come to this, diplomats, my dear brothers and sisters, we have all turned up in large numbers for today's book release function. I am very happy that members of Parliament, Secretaries, Government of India, diplomats, Vice Chancellors, professors, and also the youngsters from different institutions, they have all made it to come to this program. My dear friends, yesterday was a sad day for all of us in India. It was a day when terror raised its ugly head once again. As we pay homage to the supreme sacrifice made by our security personnel at the Pulwama terror attack, we must stand united in our resolve to make every inch of our motherland a safer place. It is unfortunate that our neighbor has been aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorist groups for long. This attempt to destabilize and impede our progress can no longer be tolerated. In fact, there is an urgent need for all countries in the world to come to a firm resolve to combat these forces of terror, these enemies of humanity. Terror has no religion. It's an enemy of humanity. The United Nations must conclude the Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism, CCIT. It should act firmly and effectively to root out terror through a multi-pronged strategy. It should recognize that peace is a prerequisite for prosperity, and the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development Goals cannot be achieved if there is no peace. I extend a warm welcome to all of you on this occasion of release of my book containing some of my speeches during my first year in office as Vice President of India and Chairman of Rajya Sabha. I am particularly grateful to Sri Pranab, the statesman, politician of our times, for honoring me by agreeing to release this book. He is one of our country's leading lights, tallest political personality, a Ratna who has done Bharat proud. We are indeed delighted to have him with us today. I have been an admirer of Sri Pranab Mukherjee right from my early days in Parliament, irrespective of political affiliation, though at that time he belonged to different political parties. His vision, his sagacity, his ability to communicate properly to different sects of the people, his character, his caliber, his capacity, and above all, his memory. I can call him, he's a living encyclopedia in India. Who remembers each and every incident, pre-India, post-independent India, any instance with the date, name, time, he'll be able to recollect and guide the nation. I'm very happy that today he has agreed to release my book. It was exactly 50 years ago that Pranabda entered Rajya Sabha for the first time in 1969, and I was re-elected to the upper house 4 times. He was also a member of the Lok Sabha Commission before becoming the President of India. He is also among the few who has been the leader of both Rajya Sabha as well as Lok Sabha. Known for his phenomenal memory and number of enriching, he has been a spectacular record of contributions as a parliamentarian and an able minister. He is one of the jewels of our country and has been accordingly chosen for the highest civilian honor of Bharat Ratna this year. I owe all of you a brief account of this book based on my mission during the first year in the present role. In a nutshell, it is an earnest endeavor to stir the consciousness of all stakeholders to introspect and lend their might to realize the quest of our nation to reach new horizons. I have made a sincere effort in that direction by recalling our past and reflecting on our present as the young India seeks to define and realize its future. My dear brothers and sisters, you are all aware, the Vice President and President, they have a protocol. They have a system. Earlier, I have been a 24/7 public personality, meeting people, greeting people, talking with people, spending time with the people, has been my pastime all these years, The moment I came here, I could not immediately adjust to the protocol and systems and customs of the Uparashtrapati, the responsibility that has been given to me. After discussion, I have decided to continue my interaction with the people in my own way. So I have decided to reach out five successful people, one segments, one students and university academicians. So I have been visiting number of universities. Since then, so far I have covered 68 universities in this 1 year and 4 months. Then I also started interacting with the scientists, with the technocrats, going to research laboratories and also technical knowledge centers across the country, right from Arunachal Pradesh to Andaman to Jammu and Kashmir. And third, I have also decided to interact with the farming community because agriculture is the basic culture of India. And 54% of the people still depend on agriculture. So agriculture is facing multi-dimensional challenges. That being the case, I have decided to continue to interact with the farming community, understand their problems, know the challenges, and also come out with some solutions and convey the same to the concerned. And thirdly, I have been visiting various cultural bodies because India is rich in culture. Our Indian traditions, our culture, our heritage is looked upon with interest and respect worldwide. We are all aware that we are an ancient civilization and we have great traditions and culture. So we have to preserve that. And part of the life is not only simply economy or having the physical needs, but also have spiritual quest and also culture, dance, music, various artists, all these activities. I have been interacting with them, attending some of their programs, encouraging and also recognizing the talent among the budding youngsters in the cultural field of the country. And fifthly, I have been interacting with public organizations like industry bodies like CIA, FK, ASSOCHAM, and also with doctors, with actors, and with the tractor running farmers, and also people in different vocations. I have been attending their national seminars, international seminars, to understand from them what are the problems, what are the experiences, and also suggesting to them that they must move lab to land, and they must pass on this knowledge. After all, science and research and technology is for the betterment of the human beings, and that should reach them directly. That has been my mission all these days, and I have been continuing with the mission. I assure you, I will continue in the rest of my tenure with this mission to reach out to people and also understand the reality of the situation and also know the solutions they have in mind and the problems they are facing. One of the ideas is recalling our past and reflecting on our present as the young India seeks to define and realize its future. This is very much required. Life of a nation, much like individual lives, unfolds in two dimensions of time and space. We need to build the future of our nation based on the past and effectively reasoning through the complexities of project. If we have to build on our past, we should be aware of our past and how ancient India contributed to world's intellectual, social and cultural heritage. Undoubtedly, India's past is rich treasure, house of extraordinary accomplishments in fields of diverse as astronomy, medicine, metallurgy, mathematics, literature, fine arts, and performing arts. Eminent thinkers like Mark Twain, Max Muller give us an outsider view of ancient India's thought. Mark Twain said, and I quote, "India is the cradle of human race, the birthplace of human speech, the mother of history, the grandmother of legend, and the great grandmother of tradition, our most valuable and most instructive material in the history of a man, are treasured up in India all day. This is what Mark Twain has said. As Max Muller has noticed, ours is a land, quote, most richly endured, with all the wealth, power, and beauty, in some parts a very paradise on earth. India, my dear brothers and sisters, was known as Vishwaguru once upon a time. And we had highest GDP of those times. And we had best relations with all the other countries. With all this richness, with heritage, with academic and economic power, but India never attacked any country any time. That is the greatness of Indian philosophy. And rightly said by the former president, Sarve Jana Sujino Bhavan, Vasudhaika Kutumbakam, the entire universe is one family. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. We should continue with that tradition. That's why I have been really advocating all these thoughts to wherever I go, to whichever community I meet, and also try to communicate them of the past of India, the glory of India, the need to preserve it, and also the need to enrich it further. There are clearly impressive landmarks in the economic history of our country, signifying an expansive growth of trade and economy. According to one estimate, India in the 17th century contributed over a quarter of the global economic output in the 17th century. We have a long history of governance and administrative structure, adopting a collective decision, making approach as seen in Sabhas, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, Vidhan Sabha, now, but those days, Sabhas, the assembly of all, and in Samiti, the meeting of the informed, but there, since immemorial. It is easy to romanticize and glamorize the past and fall into the temptation of resting on past laurels. This is not how I see history. History to me is a springboard, an inspirational tale, a motivational call to action. It is a reminder of the heights of creative endeavor reached by our predecessors, the enormous fund of social capital that each one of us has inherited. To ignore our strength accumulated over centuries is unwise. At the same time, we cannot shape our future by merely living in the past. That's the reason why I had called my reflections on 1 year in office as moving on, moving forward. To shape a bright future, we need to shun passivity. Proactive positivity is essential. As our Vedic sages have exhorted, Charaiveti, Charaiveti, Charaiveti. We must keep moving. We must, however, remember to move with a sense of direction. This is what I wanted to convey through my speeches to the farmers, to the students, to the intellectuals, to the scientists, and all our citizens I have interacted with. We need to change in the changing times. We need to adapt to the altered context. We must aim for excellence and be the pace setters. We must stretch our arms towards perfection, as Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore has exhorted us. Dear brothers and sisters, in addition to ancient history, it is equally important, in my view, to study our recent past, especially the freedom struggle and the making of our constitution. This will give us a new insights, new surge of energy to find solutions to current day problems. It will also fill us with renewed, strengthened bond with the people of our land. This is what I have been emphasizing in my conversations. It's not I am going and just giving lectures. I am first hearing them and seeing their presentation, interacting with them, and then finally used to convey my thoughts. For me, nationalism is all about this bond with the people who share a common past, a common present, and a common future. This emotion, this commonality should promote camaraderie. This implies transcending the limitations of caste, creed, region, and religion. Forging the widest possible bonding in the form of a larger identity is all about asserting that I am an Indian first. Everybody should think and act Indian first. Nationalism is an overreaching umbrella under which all our immediate identities are subsumed to form a larger character. Unfortunately, certain misinformed individuals and organizers are fomenting trouble and creating divisions where none existed before. In a country that has shown the power of peaceful coexistence and non-violence to the world, such acts of bigotry and narrow sectarian should be strongly condemned. While my engagement with farmers, students and scientists across the states in the country filled me with tremendous optimism about the future of the country, there are moments when I feel a little unhappy at the way we are conducting ourselves. Probably this is because of my creative dissatisfaction and a certain irresistible urge to remedy the situation. That is my weakness and that is my strength also. The other of you would have watched with dismay the way the budget session of Rajya Sabha had just concluded. The President of India, the highest constitutional functionary of our country and whose name every decision is taken and implemented, addressed the members of both House of Parliament at the start of the session. It is customary and a constitutional propriety that each member of Parliament adopts a motion of thanks for such an address. But in Rajya Sabha, for over a week, no concern was shown to do so, even though I appealed several times. What could have been a platform for discussing all the burning issues became a platform of confrontation and disruption. Finally, on the last day of the session, the motion was adopted without any debate. A precious opportunity for debate on public issues was lost, and debate was given a rebate. In the interim budget, the government has proposed direct income benefit for our 12 crore small and marginal farmers breathing under distress. While there is a huge potential political slugfest about the farm sector distress, the parties and the members of the upper house did not deem it fit to discuss and analyze the same and bring fresh ideas to the table. This is one area which needs utmost attention by all in the parliament, by the Niti Aayog, by the press, by the political parties and people. Because you know that India is a huge country, we have 130 crore population, we have food security, but we don't know what will happen to the future. We must have homegrown food security. You cannot depend on imported food security. You are not a small country like Dubai or Singapore or other countries in size. You are a huge country. So we need to have sustainable development in agriculture and make agriculture viable. People of India expected, many of the members also have given notice for discussion on agriculture, but unfortunately we could not have of that because of disruptions. It is very unfortunate that our legislatures, instead of becoming effective forums of debate, are being reduced to disruptive platforms. I'm sorry to say this. This growing tendency, in my view, is a clear negation of the written of our constitutional makers. In a way, it is an affront to the spirit of the Constitution of India. It is an apathy towards hopes and aspirations of the people. It is utter disregard for people's mandate. It's a betrayal of the people's faith in these pillars of democracy. Dr. Ambedkar had with great foresight warned us almost 70 years ago when he said, quote, "However good a constitution may be, it is sure to turn out a bad because those who are called to work it happens to be bad lot. However bad a constitution may be, it may turn out to be good if those who are called to work it happen to be good lot." See the vision of Dr. Ambedkar. It's a matter of concern that political discourse is reaching a new low. In recent years, we should reverse this trend at the earliest. People in public life should understand that they are only rivals, not enemies. We should consider each one of our friends who are in different political spectrum. They are all our rivals only. It's only competition, healthy competition that's required. I have been quoting Pranab Das mantra of discuss, debate and decide, but not disturb. It is unfortunate that when I meet the leaders every day in the morning, some of them, they tell me, "Sir, today the house cannot function normally because the issue has cropped up and we have instructions from the leaders." It is indeed a sad commentary of our system if the political leadership takes this kind of approach. I would like to say that the leader of opposition, Sri Gulam Nabi Azad, has often shared his concern with me about the state of affairs, but perhaps there are so many cross currents that are at work. Ultimately, we all seem to be passive spectators or tacit contributors to this theatre of declining standards. Against this backdrop of worrisome functioning of our parliament, state legislatures, situation is no better. This disruptive, dysfunctional tendency needs to be made an election issue. This is the suggestion I want to put before the people. People need to monitor the functioning of the legislature and also the conduct of various parties and the elected representatives. I am not saying it keeping in view this session or this parliament, this tenure or conduct of this party or that party. We have been witnessing across the country. I have been in public life for more than 40 years and I have experience of legislature in the state and experience of parliament here for more than 20 years. And I have been a keen reader of what is happening in various legislatures across the country. The story is no different. When you see the scenes in happening in different legislatures, you feel pain. Sometimes I say that nothing shall go on the card. And I am trying to see that the prestige of the house is preserved. Because the moment you telecast, earlier idea was, if you telecast the right proceedings, then it will have some effect and members will function in a more responsible manner. But the experience seems to be otherwise. So, keeping that in mind, I would like to say that people direct their representatives hoping that they would articulate their hopes and aspirations in the legislature and do the needful by way of making laws and raising issues of public importance so as to make a difference to their lives. Dysfunctional legislature strengthen the demand for various institutions. They say they will be recall also. But to what extent it's possible, feasible in the context of India, that has to be seen. Any short-sighted attempt to cross the line by any institution ends up by harming the spirit of unity and balance. Our judiciary has an important role in making future of our nation. It is a key institution for ensuring the rule of law through timely dispensation of justice. It is disturbing to note the heavy pendency of cases and fact that 67% of the prisoners are under trials. The formidable challenge to our socio-economic development of our country need to be overcome with the judiciary playing a constructive role. We must not allow any erosion of public trust in these institutions. The law enforcement and justice dispensation must not only be seen, be swift, objective and fair, must appear to be so in public view. The recent happenings, I need not elaborate, they make people sad. Media is an important institution of an effective democracy. It should function medium of empowerment for development through informed action. Media, M-E-D-I-A, medium of empowerment for development and informed actions. That is the media, that is the purpose of media. This is the title of one of the chapters in this book. My suggestion to the media is to correlate the text with the context for informed communication to the readers and viewers. Media should expose wrongdoers, those who are violating the sanctity of our parliamentary procedure, legislative procedure and decorum. They need to be critical of such behavior rather than highlight disruptive action. This is not being done by the media mostly, unfortunately. I appeal to the media to focus on the constructive debates. Encourage people who come prepared and make a substantial contribution to the functioning of the legislature, thereby bringing changes that are required in the policy formulation of the country, rather than highlighting these acts of unparliamentary behavior and giving encouragement for the oho. If you do like this, then we will be in the headlines. That's not a headline, it's a deadline. It's not in tune with the main line of the people. That should not be the line of our constitution. We need to evolve a new normal in their functioning and ensure a new institutional equilibrium to serve the people of this country. The world order is passing through unprecedented rapid changes, unforeseen directions, posing challenges to our present and future. Young aspiration India is yearning for a transformation. Transformation in governance, transformation in the mindset, transformation in the way we land, work and live. Ultimately, what each Indian is looking for is to shape our nation into a country that harnesses the innate potential of our each individual, to make our country an economically vibrant hub and a country that ensures high quality of life to all its citizens. The prospects of such future are bright. The entire world is looking towards India. The World Bank report, the World Economic Forum report, the ADB report, the International Monetary Fund report, the ratings of various rating agencies, all are focusing on India. India is a place of happiness. We must really take up this advantage of the same. The world economy is doing down 3%. And even neighbor, powerful economy, China, also is 6.8. India is the only country which is moving at 7.3, 7.4. Thanks to the collective efforts of the government at the center and the state, and also the local bodies, this is becoming possible. So we must all develop positivity, and we must strengthen our institutions, legislature, judiciary, executive, bureaucracy. All the efforts are needed on the part of all stakeholders to do their best to convert this into a great opportunity. The key challenge lies in handling our present to lay strong foundations for such a future. We have no option but to transform Swarajya. We have achieved a Swarajya for all. Development has no meaning unless it reaches the last man. Antyodaya, just now, Pranabdha has quoted. Gandhiji's vision, Dindala Upadhyay's vision, Ram Manohar Loihya's vision, Dr. Ambedkar's vision, Antyodaya, jo antima pankti mein baithe, unka uttan pahle hona chahiye. It should be the agenda of the country. Development, and development alone must become the agenda of all political parties. Divisive tendencies must be curbed. Divisive thinking must be given up. And the positivity must come into public life rather than opposing everything. Opposition has got a right to oppose. That's why I say, let the government propose, opposition oppose, and let the house dispose. That is the way the house has to come. We are likely to be the world's fifth largest economy, soon and possibly. The largest in due course, when faster economic growth is no advantage, we need to ensure inclusive development. Every section of the society, the downtrodden, the suppressed, the oppressed people, the poor people, the agricultural labor, they all should feel that they have a stake in the development story of the country. The fruits of development should reach them. We need to make our growth more sustainable. I have repeatedly underscored in my speeches that there are favorable winds of change today. There is a sound institutional structure in place. The economic fundamentals are strong. There is a demographic dividend waiting to be realized. 65% of the Indian population is below 35 years. No other country has got such an Indian population. We must harness this. We have to only move from ideas to implementation, from rhetoric to action. My dear friends, as I said at the start, my mission as articulated in this book is to connect the India of the past with the present and look at the future possibilities through the eyes of our academic and scientific institutions, through our youth, women and farmers, through our entrepreneurs and industries. In short, I believe there are numerous architects of tomorrow's India who just needed a facilitative, responsive, encouraging state to unleash the force of growth. Of particular interest to me is agriculture. I believe significant structural transformation is required in order to make agriculture more profitable and sustainable. I take inspiration from the census building approach towards the common concerns exposed by Vedic seers. Let us all gather in assembly and speak with one voice, Vedas. Let our minds be one of accord, not discord. May our counsel be the same. Let the assembly consist of equals. Let our minds be alive and also our thoughts. Let our hopes and aspirations be the same, and let our hearts beat in unison so that we may live in harmony and happiness. It's the same from Vedas. We must draw inspiration from this. My effort after I took over as the Vice President has been to focus on issues that are crucial for India's development. My extensive interaction with the wide cross-section of the people population have convinced me that a change is possible if we can get our act together. My dear sisters and brothers, let me now touch upon another important aspect of our democratic structure. In a few months from now, the country will go to polls. I have had a dream to transform the quality of our democracy. Free and fair elections have been the cornerstone of our democracy. But what about the political process itself? I would like to see more men and women being elected as legislators and parliamentarians with a national outlook and having in them certain characteristics which I have usually described as the virtues of four C's: character, caliber, capacity and conduct. We the people have to ensure that the vicious four C's, other C's, cash, caste, community and criminality are no longer allowed to vitiate the political system. This is my advice to the people. Only then we can proudly say that ours is not only the largest democracy but also one of the best in the world. We need higher standards of accountability in public life. Political parties must evolve a code of conduct for their functionaries. The public at large has a right to know the contribution of their representatives to development of the constituency and their conduct in the legislature. They should demand a report card from the public representatives and make a critical assessment of their effectiveness. This ideally should be decisive factor and yardstick at the time of voting in the elections. To conclude, I need to place on record my appreciation to my secretary, Dr. Ravi Subbarao, and other officials in my secretariat for their diligence in putting together this comparison, adequately capturing the various canvas covered during 1 year. I also compliment Minister, Secretary, Information and Broadcasting, and more importantly, Director General of Publication Division and her team for tirelessly working on this project for over 6 months. I once again convey my gratitude to Bharat Ratna, Sri Pranab Mukherjee, for gracing this occasion and releasing this book. I can only tell you, friends, frankly, you know, I have been always speaking from the bottom of my heart. I have that habit of speaking frankly. I do not have any great background of family. I come from an agriculture family, humble agriculture family. Of course, I am proud of it. I have no political people in my family. But commitment to the cause, constant endeavor to learn more and more, learn. I used to study the speeches of the great legislators in Andhra Pradesh Assembly. I used to go to the library and read what the native Sonam has said, what Karimal Nagiri has said, what Kudaramani Venkateswar has said, what Zubur Agnan has said, what other leaders have said. I used to read each and every thing. Then after I came to Parliament also in national politics also, I used to read Shyam Prasad Mukherjee speeches, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru speeches, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel speeches and also his life. And also the speeches made by great parliamentarians like Kiran Mukherjee, Bhupesh Gupta, Jyotirbhai Vasu, Indrajit Gupta, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Nadpayee, Pilu Modi, Minu Masani. These great parliamentarians, they have enriched our Indian parliamentary system. I try to always read, try to understand, and to the extent possible. I have also gone through the life and teachings and preachings of the first president, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, a genius person who has occupied this office earlier, and also go through the speeches made by different presidents of different tenures, and also life and teachings and preachings of Abdul Kalam, and also regularly I used to follow the speeches made by Pranab Da in various occasions. That is the treasure of knowledge I acquired, not because of any hereditary thing, not because of any other distinct consideration. So I appeal to the younger generation in public life, and I appeal to the legislators and parliamentarians, please focus your attention, go through the speeches made, contributions made, traditions established, levels of debate they have taken the parliament, legislature, and see to it that we also live up to the expectation of the people. People have great expectations. Legislators and parliamentarians are idols for the people, leaders for the people. If the, there is a saying, Yadha Raja, Tadha Praja, not our Raja who is sitting here, member of parliament, Raja means king. If the ruler behaves in a dignified manner, if the various functionaries in public life, parliamentarians and legislators and heads of various departments, if they conduct themselves, the country will be benefited by their rich experience and others also will follow. I only conclude by saying, Sri Advaniji used to tell one of the senior parliamentarians of our present generation, used to say that ideal behavior is more important than ideology. Siddhantam kanna acharanam enna ani eppudu cheptunnaru. More than an ideology, ideal behavior is more important. So country is watching. The younger generation have got higher aspirations and expectations. The world is looking to us. we must behave properly and act together. That is only my wish, and I hope things will improve in future. Things will improve in future, in the coming days in Parliament, after this round of elections, then again when the Parliament meets, I hope there will be improvement in the conduct of the legislatures and the Parliament, and every political party will think in that direction. Thank you very much for responding to our invitation. Different sections of the public life, they all have come here today, and I would like to thank once again the Information Broadcasting Ministry for this publication, and also thank the Minister without him, the whole senior minister in the government, and particularly my thanks are once again to the great statesman politician Bharat Ratna, Shri Pranab Mukherjee. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.